Good morning. Welcome, welcome. It is still the resurrection season, so we can continue to exclaim, Jesus Christ is risen. That is why we gather. That is why we exist as a community. But what have you seen that makes you a part of this? Well, whatever the case, I am glad you are here this morning, whether you're a first-timer, a lifetimer, or anything in between, in person or via any sort of media. It is better here because you are here. Take some time to connect with us today, especially if you are in need of ministry services. Call, text, email, message us on Facebook. Stop in at the office, talk to any of the ministry staff or leaders in person. We want to know what's going on in your life so that we can respond with God's love to you and to your concerns. The Brown Get to Know Your Neighbor pads are an excellent way to make that connection, and also for you to be invited to communion today. It's your written invitation to partake in the Lord's Supper today. Or those tear-off cards in the bulletin, also the prayer cards. It's a great way for you to connect with us. Let us know what's going on, how we can pray for you, how we can be to service to you. The risen Lord calls us to see the truth of the cross and the resurrection, the peace and the forgiveness that we can share. And that's why we sing. So rise with me as we join together.
Thank you.
season of Easter, we'll be replacing the confession and forgiveness with a reminder of our thanksgiving for baptism. We all participate in the resurrection of Christ. It's all true in our lives that Jesus Christ is risen. Because of our baptism, we are connected to that reality. So we will, in this season of Easter, be spending this time in thanksgiving for baptism. So, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Join with me in prayer. Almighty and eternal God, the strength of those who believe and the hope of those who doubt, may we, who have not seen, have faith in you and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. First reading is Acts 5, 27 through 32. Peter has been arrested for proclaiming the good news of Jesus' death and resurrection. His response to the charges of the high priest summarizes the early church's proclamation of forgiveness of sin through repentance. This is a good summary for our hearts too. The first reading. When they had brought the apostles, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus up, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." Word of God, word of life. Psalms 150. Please read responsibly the assembled portions in the bold print. Alleluia, praise God in the holy temple. Praise God in the mighty firmament. Praise God with trumpet sound. Praise God with lyre and harp.
Praise God with tambourine and dance. Praise God with strings and
pipes. Praise God with resounding cymbals. Praise God with loud clanging cymbals.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Would you rise if we please and be prepared to hear the words of the gospel?
For the second Sunday of Easter, John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. We pick up the story at the first Easter, the very evening of the resurrection. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in them, in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. I'd like to invite the youngest members forward, though. I need you to come somewhere where you can see the screens. Come up front and get a good view of the screens. We need to go to the next slide there, too. All right, make sure you can see the screens. You need to be sitting where you can see the screens, because what we're going to be looking at is on the screens. It's going to help us kind of remember this story of Thomas today. So, yeah, okay, this picture is on the bulletins this morning. This picture on the screens, Who do you think's in that picture? What do you think? We got Jesus. Yeah, he's probably the guy on the right-hand side there that has his hands out like that. Who else do you think we got there? Well, Jesus is God, so you're right there. Who else do you think we got there? I think the guy kneeling in front of him is probably Thomas. What do you think?
Thomas.
And?
James.
And what? No. Okay. Well, we're not sure about the other two, but I know the guy in front of him there is Thomas, and he's looking at the holes in Jesus' hands. You see the marks there on that picture? Let's go to the next picture, because it's... Okay, we got a couple of guys, again, three different guys, and the guy with it, you see that, actually, if you look at this picture, it shows up a little better. Thomas has actually got his finger stuck inside of Jesus' side. That was when Jesus was killed on the cross, the soldier stabbed him in the side with a spear just to make sure he was dead. And here he's alive again, and Thomas is going, really? Can you imagine sticking your hand in somebody's scar like that? It's like, ooh, man. But Jesus knows Thomas needs that. Because Thomas missed it the first time Jesus showed up. And he said, I'm not going to believe it until I see it. Now, we don't know where Thomas was that first night. I don't know. Maybe he was out on a date with a new girl. I don't know. But he wasn't there. But so the next time, there he is. Let's go to the next picture. This is a different artist figuring it out what it looks like. And so Thomas is the guy with the fuzzy beard there going, whoa, man, put that away, dude. But it's like, no, if you want to touch it, go ahead. Because Jesus knows that sometimes we need the touch. We need to see it for ourselves. Let's go to the next one. And then what Thomas does, and this is kind of a different view of it, a different idea. We got Thomas down on his knees, kind of like you guys are down there now, and he's going, my Lord and my God. He knows that Jesus is really alive. He knows for sure that Jesus Christ is risen. I wanted you to show you these pictures of this story from the story this morning because, well, sometimes we're all a little bit like Thomas, and we just need to show it to see it. And hopefully you can see God's love and the love the people love you with and in the way we do things here in church. Thanks for coming up. I wanted to share that story with you today. What about the rest of you? What have you seen? Have you seen the peace that the risen Lord offers? Have you seen the forgiveness that the crucified Lord gives? Have you seen the power that you have been given to be the ones who share peace and give forgiveness? Proclaim the truth and the reality of forgiveness. Very much like you and me, the disciples in those first weeks after Jesus' resurrection needed to know about peace and forgiveness. They had lots to fear. They were afraid that the Romans were going to come and get them. They were afraid that the Jewish authorities were going to come and get them. They were afraid maybe they were going to end up on some cross or somewhere else being put to death. And besides that, they hear this rumor that Jesus is alive. And if you've been hanging out with a guy that, you know, walks on water, raises other people from the dead, heals people just by touching them or saying it, and, you know, you ran away from the guy in his hour of need, abandoned him when he was being crucified, and you hear that he's back, you kind of might think he's going to come and get you. Because, I mean, look at this. Jesus had told these people time and time and time again, I'm going to be tortured. I'm going to be crucified. On the third day, I'm going to be raised again. And not one of them, not a single one of them figured it out when it happened. Every one of them were like, what? No way. Or they just, I don't know, did they ignore it? So, you know, it's like the teacher. Like, now, okay, children, What did I say? I'll be back. What did I say? See, you guys get it right away. But it's like these people that have been hanging out with Jesus for years and he's been telling them for months, they don't get it. So it's like, what did I tell you? It's like, no. Maybe they were just a little bit afraid for their own skins. Maybe they were guilty. Fear comes from guilt sometimes too. They had a lot to fear. Every one of them, except for John and Jesus' mother and the other Mary, had run away. That was the only three that hung out at the cross. It was just the three of them. The rest of them had all run away, went into hiding. All of them had failed to listen to Jesus when he told them that this would happen. And all of the men, sorry guys, I got to give us up here. All of the men had refused to believe the women when they told him that they'd seen an empty tomb and that the angels had said he was alive. So the women maybe had a little bit going for them, but the men were out of luck, guys. All of the men had failed to believe the women when they tried to tell them the truth that Jesus Christ is risen. Then you got Peter. Three times he had denied that he even knew Jesus. After being, oh, yeah, I'll go all the way to whatever you need, Jesus. Yeah, I'm in there. I'll go to prison. I'll die. Yeah. I don't know him. Nope. Swore, in fact, he didn't know him. Three times. So if anybody was maybe, you know, Jesus is going to come back, I'm not sure I want him back after what I would know. We don't know all of the emotional baggage that they were carrying in this, and we get a glimpse of parts of the stories of them, and there were hundreds of stories. We just get a couple of them here and there in Scripture. It'd be so cool to hear the rest of the guys on the edge, the women on the edge that were like hanging out and like, well, whatever. And there was just so many stories. Believers in Jesus whose faith and hope were tattered to shreds by the cross, not knowing, not seeing, not understanding what really happened there. Very much like you and me, the disciples in those first weeks of Jesus' resurrection needed to know the peace. That's why it's what he leads with. He comes into the locked room. He comes into their locked existence. He comes into their fear. He comes into their doubt. He comes into whatever emotion is charging, whatever anger is going on in their lives. He comes right into that and goes, peace. Every time he shows up, peace. You know, maybe the disciples were kind of at each other's throats. Well, Peter, you denied him three times. Yeah, well, you ran away. Well, you left your clothes behind. Well, peace. Every time. And it's the same for us, brothers and sisters. Every time Jesus comes into our lives to the first, what he leads with is peace. He might have us getting busy after that, but he leads with peace and forgiveness. Very much like you and me, the disciples in those first weeks of his resurrection needed to know peace and forgiveness, and that it was theirs to share. Their community would falter and fall apart. Their community would disintegrate. The church would never happen. The Holy Spirit would have nothing to do in their lives if it didn't come first with the power to forgive. They had to learn to forgive themselves. They had to learn to forgive each other. They had to know that Jesus forgave them, just like you and me. And Jesus delivers peace. The gift of the Holy Spirit, the reality of being able to see forgiveness, not just from Jesus, but fully at work in their entire futures. It's as if Jesus says to them and then to us, you can forgive. You can forgive. I forgive, Jesus tells us. I forgive you. I forgive all the stuff going around, but you You can forgive from your own heart, from in your own circumstance, in your own anger, in your own doubt, in your own fear, your own animosity, your own people, in your own family. You can forgive. You can. You can. I don't know how many times as pastor I've heard your lament. Oh, pastor, I don't know. That whole business about forgiveness. I know God forgives them, but I can never do it. Yes, you can. Bull hockey. You can forgive. You can forgive. The Holy Spirit continues to be breathed into the church, into us, through our baptism. That's why we began this Sunday with remembering our baptism. The gift of the Holy Spirit is part of what we get in baptism. You have that gift. You can forgive. Let me put it to you this way. If you're not forgiving, I don't think you want to. Because it feels good to be mad at Peter for running for talking Jesus down three times. Feels good to be mad at John for running away naked. Feels good to be mad at Thomas for not believing the first time around. Doesn't it? The church doesn't get anywhere from the very first appearance of Jesus. It's not going to get anywhere without forgiveness. The gift of the Holy Spirit, the reality of being able to see the forgiveness not only from Jesus, but fully at work in our own futures. You can forgive. Forgive yourselves. Forgive each other. Jesus says, forgive the religious and the political and military forces that have frightened you. Forgive them all. Jesus breathes the power of peace and forgiveness into their lives. Jesus delivers. And even more powerfully for Thomas, Jesus shows up the first time and he says, hey, look at this, my side, my hands. Thomas, I wonder what Thomas was so, why he was so angry or so doubting. What was tearing at him? You know, that he missed it? Was he feeling guilty that he wasn't there with the guys the first night? Was he disappointed because he was doing whatever he was doing and he wasn't there? Was he angry at God, at himself? At the other disciples, how come you got that and I didn't? Was it just a logical wrestling in his brain? I can't wrap my head around this, a logical intellectual doubt. In the end, maybe it doesn't matter. We all have our doubts. We all have our reasons for backing away from faith and love and forgiveness. But Jesus meets us just as he met Thomas right there head on. Here, is this what it takes? Touch me. Go ahead, put your finger in there. Dig around. It's really me. Peace. I love you. You're forgiven. Forgive each other. And maybe, brothers and sisters in Christ, this story is meant to speak to the emptiness and the hurt of our own souls, our own doubts. And instead of remembering doubting Thomas, we might more clearly remember his proclamation, my Lord and my God. We can echo Psalm 150, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Every fiber of my being, praise the Lord. That's what Thomas did. In the end, it doesn't matter what Thomas's doubt sounded like, if it was anger or fear, because all of this, Jesus coming then, Jesus coming now, Jesus in the bread and wine, Jesus in the water, Jesus in our songs, Jesus in our hearts, all of it, Jesus in the story, Jesus for Peter, Jesus for Thomas, Jesus for the world, all of this is for one thing, so that you believe, even though you have not seen. And believing you have life. And in that life we all see, yes we do, forgiven peace. Jesus Christ is risen. And since we didn't actually see that event, we still get to be the ones who bear the blessing Jesus offers of believing. And being the ones who show the world that peace and that forgiveness, the very same peace and forgiveness that Jesus breathes into us in the Holy Spirit. That peace, we've seen it. That forgiveness, we've seen it. Now we show it so the world around us sees. Did you see that? Sing with me. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Rise with me, please. For the season of Easter, we'll be using the more detailed Nicene Creed to confess our faith. Join with me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. That is who we are. That is where our peace comes from. May that peace of the Lord be with you always. Thank you. Take some time. Share that peace with each other. As we begin the process of gathering this morning's offering, thank you for being here today. Thank you for offering of yourselves and your voices and your time and your talents and a little bit of your financial gift as well. Thank you for your support. Without you, we cannot keep going. So thank you so very much. Little information that you need to know moving forward about our ministries coming up. Our semi-annual meeting is coming up on the 25th of the month, right after this service. It's a time where we put forward the leaders, the committees and council and that sort of folks for our year ahead. So check in on a couple other necessary items doing the church here together. So the 25th, be looking forward to that. Guests and visitors, you're here with us this morning. Please check for your welcome gift at the welcome table in the entryway this morning. Remember Generations in Faith Together. Gift is going on each week between services, a faith growth time for people of all ages together. So remember that. A little note this morning, we will be recognizing a number of young people who have been going through GIFT this last little bit as we've been learning about communion, and they'll be celebrating their first communion with us here today at this service. This morning, we baked the bread for this service that's fresh out of the oven this morning, so no wafers for you folks. It's real bread today, thanks to our pre-communion class today. If you would like to take home a lily, we have several on the staircase up to the loft and several up here in front. This would be a good time to take them home while they're still fresh and lovely, or bring them to a shut-in, a friend, a neighbor, in your own house, put them in your own garden. Take them, please, and let the trumpet sound in your own life of the reality of the new life of Christ in our lives. At this time, I want to turn things over to Cindy Haglin, who has a couple of things going on in our ministry ahead that she'd like to share with us. Cindy?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Cindy, and I'm really excited for this chance to give you an update on our Matching Fund Challenge. But first, I'd like us just to take a moment and reflect. Because it's the season of Easter, and last week we heard Pastor Chris encourage us to keep Easter. Well, I couldn't let go of that all week. I thought about it, and I just want to tell you quickly and briefly what Easter means to me and what keeping Easter might mean. On April 18th, 1978, was about 20 days after Easter that year, I found myself standing in a cemetery because I was burying my baby girl. I was devastated. Initially, upon her death, I remember, I will never forget the feeling that this is too much. I can't do this. How could I bear to bury my baby? But as I stood there at the cemetery, totally a mess, I felt an arm around my shoulder. It was my younger brother, and the four words that he whispered gently changed everything. He said, "Thank God for Easter." And in that instant, I got it. I got what I knew in my head. I felt it in my heart. I felt it to my soul. This is not just about this life. It's about our eternal souls. And because of the victory of Easter, we can spend eternity together. In that instant, I knew for certain that I will see my baby girl again. Because of his perfect love to suffer in my place, we can spend eternity together. We keep Easter. We have hope and joy. That's the source. So he is risen.
He's risen indeed. Hallelujah.
So, since you and me and Pastor and Ryan and Dean and Linda and Marty and Mary and Bruce and Mike, we all get to spend eternity together, we may as well get a jump start and get to know and support and love one another right here, right now, today, so that we can know him better, so that others might know him. I believe that if we can share his love right here at our Savior's, others will see that God is at work here, and they'll want to know him as we do. We have opportunities. The nominating team met between services, I believe, and they're looking for people right now who are not afraid to become involved. And what better way to know him better and share his love than gathering for 45 minutes at GIFT, Faith 5, Generations in Faith Together, right here every Sunday between services. I am completely confident that you can and will respond to the call. How can I be so confident? Well, in case you aren't aware, in short, our 2016 budget came up short, $40,000. But we've been blessed with an opportunity. A few generous folks have offered a challenge to match funds raised up to $20,000. The source of my confidence? A few weeks ago, Bruce Larson stood up here and offered some great words of encouragement, and you responded. Bruce reported that at that point, we had gathered 30% of that $20,000 goal. Today, I'm very happy to report that we are at 69%. Bruce, he really put the pressure on me in this talk today. Now, we're about $6,000 shy of meeting that challenge. We're so close. I'm grateful that I get to spend eternity with you guys. That's why I'm confident. It's time for a final push. The envelopes provided out there by the chart, you can use for a donation, or just write match challenge on the memo line of your check. We also get to have some fun as we push together toward our goal. The stewardship and the fellowship teams have joined forces and are planning a super fun opportunity for us both to get to know each other, since, you know, we're going to spend eternity together, share his love, know him better, and pull in the dollars that we need, and eat some amazing chili. The first annual Our Savior's Chili Cook-Off is just 2 weeks away. Sunday, April 17th, 5 o'clock, right here at our church home. You are not going to want to miss this. Check out the prize. Now, there was some confusion at the first service, so I want to clarify. It's the trophy that is the prize. We're not giving away Caitlin. Her mom would be mad at me. We already have tens of entries. People who are confident that their chili is unbeatable and excited for a chance to prove it. There's a sign-up sheet in the narthex if you want to challenge them. Now, you guys get to be the judge, and not only do you get to judge the contest, but you also get to bid at a really great silent auction. So even if you have to miss the event because you've got something going on in your world, perhaps you can help by putting together a basket or an item to share and donate for the silent auction. We could use more silent auction items. But come, eat, enjoy, share, and don't forget your checkbook. Hey, let's keep Easter. Let's share his joy and his love. Let's get to know him better. Let's dig deep and surpass our financial goal so that we have the resources we need and so that others might know him. It's why we're here. It's what we're made for. Thank you.
There's a distinct possibility that that will be the traveling trophy. There will be a plaque put on there for this year's winner of the chili cook-off, and it may turn into an annual event, so we'll have to see. Just so you know, there's a couple of prize-winning cooks involved in this. Yesterday at a fundraiser for John Lund up at Grace Lutheran of Hermantown, Via de Cristo participant, our chili from our church won first prize. It's back there. Dave has the trophy for that back there. So the bar is high. So that was judged by a celebrity judge. This time you people get to be the judges. So we'll see how that turns out. But yeah, so thanks, Dave, and our Via de Cristo crew for helping out with that. So would you rise with me as we bless your gifts with our offering prayer? Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Rooted in the abundant life and love of Christ Jesus, we pray for the life of the church, the lives of people in need, and the life of all creation. Holy God of resurrection, fill us with your Holy Spirit to announce the forgiveness, the grace, the peace of the new life we see through you in Christ Jesus. Lead us to people who need to hear that good news. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Breathe new life into all of creation. Send sun to warm and water to saturate yards, fields, and mountains. Help farmers everywhere get a fair price for their labor in the coming season from your land. Set all things in order that abundance may come forth. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Open paths of cooperation between nations to care for refugees, survivors of natural disaster, and people living through war. Bless the efforts of peacemaking troops, diplomats, relief organizations as they seek to minister and care for those who are displaced by any concerns, and as they work to foster peace in the world. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Pour out your enduring mercy to strengthen those who persevere in difficult times, to be with those who are healing after surgery or who are facing surgery. Be with those who face chronic pain or acute illness. Be with those who are facing ongoing depression or other emotional turmoil. Be with those living with cancer or infections, issues of bone or sinew or joint, including those that we name before you in our hearts. Bring your healing, guide us all to places where we may find shelter in your presence. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Gather together the various gifts of this community and unite us in praise. Harmonize the sound and movement of instruments, voices, hands, feet, bodies, and minds. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Unify your church in grace, peace, and forgiveness. Your whole church of every denomination or theology, every level of organization from each of us as individuals, to committees, to congregations, to regional and international expressions, remind all of us that we are united in the cross and the resurrection of Jesus. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Whatever else you, O Lord, see that we need, whatever lies unspoken in our hearts, whatever we've forgotten to talk about, whatever lies just out of reach from our minds to even grasp the reality of, help us to turn it all over to you in the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we prepare to hear and remember the words of our Lord Jesus, who gave us this Holy Supper, hear us, O Lord. In response to the call of God, the command of Jesus Christ, and the bond of our common faith, we come to the table. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." In response to the love of our Creator and remembering the death and resurrection of Jesus, our Savior, we come to the table. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." In the grapes, we have a reminder of God's love and forgiveness for the youngest of our assembly, a reminder of the same story, the same truth, the same grace, the same love of God. Following our Lord's command and responding to our need for forgiveness, we come. I ask you to be seated. Several young people have recently completed their communion instruction this morning. In fact, learning the basics of how our celebration of Jesus' Last Supper invites us to remember and experience the depth and wonder of God's grace given and shed for you. As their names are read, I invite those young people and their families to please stand. Joseph Robinson, Eli Maunu, Liz Maunu, Joyce Cascella, Annabelle Skoland, Ethan Lindgren, Aaliyah Lindgren, Lexi Warner, Trevor Leach, and Grady Knudsen. Together, let us welcome them. We rejoice with you, our brothers and sisters, as you take this important step in your journey of discovering and affirming the faith we share. Yeah, this is your line. There we go. You may be seated. These new communicants get to be the first ones to come forward for communion today as they are remembered with a glass for their communion from our altar guild. The rest of you are invited to come up as the ushers invite you to do so, coming up through the center aisle and returning back. If you need to stop and pray on your way, please do so. If you'd like to remember your baptism with the water, you can please do so that as well. Gluten-free at the left-hand station, grapes and grape juice available at all stations. We'll be with you in just a moment. Please rise with me. May the depth and the wonder of this blessing, the truth of this grace, the peace, the forgiveness that comes with this body and blood of Jesus so strengthen you and keep you that you can do nothing but show others that same grace, that same peace, that same forgiveness. Pray with me. We give you thanks, O God, that you make your home with us, bringing heaven to earth in this holy meal. Fill us with your Spirit as we go from here, that we may wipe away tears, tend those in mourning and pain, seek the healing of the nations, and bring to earth the presence of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Eternal God, whose glory is revealed in the crucified and risen Lord, bless those who go forth to share your word and sacrament with our sisters and brothers who are sick or homebound or cannot be with us. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those to whom we bring this communion in the body and blood of your Son, that we may all feast upon your abundant love made known in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of the Lord God Almighty, the blessing of Christ the Lamb who was slain, the blessing of the Holy Spirit of truth be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
first Sunday of the month, so you get to give to the food shelf and food bank. So remember that on your way out. Hallelujah. Go in peace. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.